Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. What are you training for? What keeps you coming back day after day, especially when things get hard? Whether you're looking to improve your body composition, training for a personal best, or simply exercising for optimal health in body and mind, it's important to create clarity around our goals. And to help us make sure we're training the right way, avoiding injury and focusing on the results that really matter, I'm happy to be here today with the one and only Jay Ferruggia, a coach, writer, and host of the Renegade Strength Show. With 27 years of experience and expertise, this dude is the real deal. But before we get to the interview with Jay, here's a quick announcement. As you may know, my wife Allison and I started Wild Superfoods about 5 years ago to bring you some of our favorite health-boosting supplements. We built Wild Superfoods to create the highest quality health supplements you can trust at a reasonable, fair, and good price to you. But with skyrocketing prices in manufacturing and shipping, we've made the difficult decision to move in a different direction. We're not going to compromise on quality, raise prices to eye-watering levels, or sell out to some multinational corporation. So for now, we'll be shutting down wildsuperfoods.com and retiring the brand, at least for a bit. But if you'd like to get one last discount and stock up on collagen cocoa, future greens, vitamin D stack, mega omegas, or any other of our favorite supplements, you have one last chance. Just go to wildsuperfoods.com and you can save 15% off with the coupon code SAVE15. That's SAVE15. And for all of you who have purchased from Wild Superfoods, or even better, been subscribed, some of you for more than 5+ years, thank you so much for your support. You've really helped keep this show and our work going over the years, as well as hopefully you've been topping up your nutrients in the best way possible through some really hard times, especially health-wise. So we're proud of the work that we've done. We think it's the right time to make sure that we're not raising prices to some ridiculous level. It's really important to us to deliver on our promises, stay true to our mission, and also make sure that we can open up doors to new projects down the road. So it's a tough decision to make right now, and we appreciate your support in the past, right now, as well as everything that will be coming down the road. So thanks for sticking with us and believing in what we do. One more time, if you want a last discount at wildsuperfoods.com, use the code SAVE15 and just go to wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like to support this show, please go ahead and make sure that you're subscribed to the Fat Burning Man podcast. Even better, leave us a quick review wherever you listen to your podcast and share this episode or another episode you like with a friend you care about. And if you'd like to stay up to date with everything that's coming next, please go to fatburningman.com and sign up for the newsletter. And I'd be happy to send you a free quick start guide as well as many recipes to help you get started right away. And of course, if you'd like to ask any questions or you have podcast guest recommendations or areas of interest you'd like us to focus in on in the future, please don't be shy. Email me at abel@fatburningman.com. That's abel@fatburningman.com. Also, if you sign up for the newsletter, you can just hit reply to one of my emails. I read as many as I can and I answer as many as I can. I always love hearing from you. All right, on to this show with Jay Ferruggia. We're chatting about the importance of defining what you're training for, how to adjust your workouts as you age for maximum strength, energy, and pain-free recovery, why chugging a gallon of water when you wake up is a bad idea, why you should make sleep your number one health priority, how to use music to program your subconscious while exercising, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Jay. Welcome back, folks. Today, I'm honored to be here with the one and only Jay Ferruggia, a coach, writer, and host of the Renegade Strength Show. You may have seen Jay's work in Men's Health, Muscle and Fitness, Maximum Fitness, Men's Fitness, Fast Company, or on ESPN or CBS. With 27 years of experience and expertise, this dude is the real deal. He's an advisor to the NFL, MLB, and WWE athletes, as well as countless high performers. I've been following Jay's work for a decade and change, and I'm stoked he's with us today. Thanks so much for being with us, Jay.
My man, thanks for having me, pleasure.
So it's amazing because you had an underground warehouse gym where you were pumping the jams, doing it kind of the new school way all the way back then. So maybe you can just talk about, to start, what you've seen in the world of
of health and fitness and strength and conditioning and all the rest of that over the past few years, and maybe where you think we're going next, or at least what excites you about where we're going next?
Well, I mean, you know, the last few years, obviously so many people have transitioned to online, and you know, my problem with that for some people that I've talked to is they feel like they're pressured. Like, I got to go online. I got to go online. I got to stop training people. I got to get out of the gym. And I'm like, okay, do you like that? Do you like sitting in front of the computer all day? They're like, no, I hate it. I was like, what do you love doing? Being in the gym and training people.
Yeah.
So do that. You know, yeah. Like, you don't have to be online. You don't have to do anything. You got to decide what you want to do. And, you know, there's nothing that beats that personal connection, that energy, just being around people. So, but it is cool to see, like, you know, I know I'm a few years older than you, but like, we wouldn't have thought this, you know, 20, 30 years ago, that so many people would be so into training. Like, I'm 48. I remember when I was in my 20s and I was, you know, like you mentioned there, running that underground warehouse gym. I was like, man, not many people train. It's weird. But like, now it seems like everybody trains. Like, everybody's into fitness. Everybody's got the routine. Almost everybody seems to be on some kind of diet or something, like, which is cool. I think, there's a lot of maybe not so great information and people are really confused and overwhelmed. But at least they're trying, they're pushing, you know, more and more people are getting into it. So I love that. You know, whether you're doing it online, whether you're doing it in person, it's just cool to see that the world as a whole has gotten fitter. I feel like over the last, you know, I mean, you can look at stats and say we're unhealthier, but I see more people training than ever, you know? So I think that's a good thing.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I think as well, you know, just saying that, just because everyone is online as much as possible with this endless amount of content creation, which is kind of a race to the bottom at this point, even, it's really nice to have that counterpoint of being like, well, do you like that? Do you absolutely have to do that? No. Like, we haven't been on Instagram for more than a year, and people are like, what? You're not on Instagram? You used to have a big Instagram account. How do you do anything? How do you have a business or a podcast? And it's like, I don't know. Actually, it's a lot better with that, spending a bunch of time there. And so, no, whether you're a coach or you're someone who's going in for training, it's really important that you ask yourself, is this actually what I want to be doing? Or am I just kind of following what everyone else is up to these days?
Right. Yeah, totally.
And you've always been a little bit ahead of the curve, it seems like. Let me start right here, because this has been interesting too, kind of going through your work and taking a deep look into it every few years. I noticed that you posted a picture of, I think you were 39 years old, and then a picture of you at 47, and kind of the ups and downs of being a coach and training, and how we kind of build these blind spots over time. And we let ourselves go sometimes without even realizing it. And we have to ask ourselves, what are we optimizing our life for right now? Is it the partying and hanging out with friends, or is it the training and getting the personal best, or is it our body composition? So how in your own life have you navigated that? And then how do you help other people do the same?
Yeah, you know, I was the guy that was on the gym floor 12 hours a day. So I was always putting my clients first. I want them to get great results. A lot of my training was experimental. So I might say, all right, I'm going to run this for 6 to 8 weeks. I don't know if it's going to get good results or not. I'm going to give you what I know gets great results. So I'm experimenting with diets. But also, again, like, I'm telling everyone, be healthy. You got to get sleep. But I'm working 18 hours a day. I'm not getting enough sleep. I'm burnt out. I'm living on caffeine. I only have 5 minutes between clients to eat, so sometimes I'm not eating the healthiest stuff. And then what also happened later, so that was, you know, that was from 19 to my early 30s. I'm doing that. Then I moved across the country to LA. And when I got there, that was a little bit of a shift where I'm still super focused on my clients and business and whatnot. But I had missed, like, on my 21st birthday, I was in bed at 10 o'clock because I didn't have a drink. I'd have a drink, but I was probably like 22 because I was working, I was grinding, you know? So I kind of like almost had my college experience when I got to LA, where I just started having fun, I'm partying. And it was also to overcome a lot of like false narratives and self-limiting beliefs about, you know, I'm insecure, I'm shy, I'm socially awkward. So I built this huge network of people and I'm just like, this is amazing. It's what I always wanted my whole life. So I'm going out all the time and I'm making the excuse that I'm a foodie. Like, I'm eating healthy most of the time, but 5 nights a week, I'm eating like I have a TV show or something, like, you know what I mean? Like, it's insane. My good friend Bedros Koulian, I mentioned him in that post that you refer to. He and I are the same age, and so like we were 39. We're like, dude, this is our last year of our 30s. So we're going to concerts all the time. We're drinking. We're eating everything. And then I was just like, I look terrible. Like I shouldn't, you know what I mean? I feel terrible. I look terrible. And so I felt like a little bit, not so much that I had imposter syndrome, but I'm like, I'm telling all these people to do this and I don't look or feel the way I should, the way I'm telling you should. So I made a massive shift and I was like, man, I'd love to have visible abs for the first time in my life. And because when I graduated high school, I was 6 feet, 147 pounds. And I've been training for 5 years. So I have terrible genetics. But I gained like 80 pounds. I walked around at like 2 1/4 for years and years and years. And then, but then again, like when I was turning 40, I was like, man, I never had visible abs my whole life. I'd love to be able to get a six pack. So then I just went super hard on the dieting, you know, prioritizing sleep, recovery, health, all the things. And I've really never looked back since. Like I've maintained the abs for 8 or 9 years now. And, you know, I'm healthier. I feel better than ever. So, but it's a process. Everyone's got to go through. And still, I still like to have fun, you know, like you mentioned there, like, are we partying? Are we doing this? I still like to find the balance. Like, I know some people are just super Spartan and they will never do anything. And they're in bed at 8, 365. And I'm like, I respect that. I love that. But like, I gotta have a balance here and there.
Yeah. And it's good to know that there are different ways of going about this. And you can have a bit of fun as long as you dose it appropriately in the right amounts at the right time in your life. And also, if you do get out of shape, Or if life does that to you sometimes, as long as you build those skills and know how to get back, then it's not quite as freaky and as scary. But I've heard you talk about this as well, where a lot of people think that it's always about going harder. And it's not about adding more weight and more workouts necessarily to get the body composition that you're after and feel better. In fact, a lot of times it's quite the opposite, where you focus more on these lifestyle factors, you dial those in, and you actually turn down the amount that you're exercising, or you exercise more specifically. So maybe you can talk about that.
Yeah, so everybody wants to go super hard. You know, back to what we were saying before, like it's cool that the whole world seemingly, in my view, is more obsessed with training. And, you know, there's training on commercials now, which we would have never seen in the 80s and 90s. But it's all about like, I gotta go hard. I'm drowning in a pool of sweat and I'm wiping myself out. And it's like, yeah, there's a time and place for that. But don't forget that most people are sleep deprived. They have a lot of stress. They're probably living on stimulants all day. Maybe they're, you know, under eating, which is stressful to your body. It could be a million different things, right? But training is another stressor. So many times I'll get guys, you know, my age, type A, hard charging people, and they're grinding, they're doing it. And they're like, yeah, but I can't lose any weight. I can't get strong. And like, well, that's why we got to cut back on half of this stuff that you're doing. So I'll eliminate all the high intensity stuff. All the high intensity stuff is gone for at least 30 days. We'll do more low intensity cardio. We'll lift it with longer rest periods in between 2-3 minutes, trying to minimize like, you know, any kind of CNS fatigue and just overall systemic fatigue and drain, like get you feeling better. And when people are like, okay, well, what's the hierarchy? Is it the diet or the training or the interval training? I'm like, no. It's sleep, then it's stress reduction, then we could talk about diet, then training, and then cardio and things like that. But we got to, you know, get that stuff in check first and foremost, which isn't the, you know, the coolest, the sexiest thing, but like you're getting nowhere if you don't manage those things.
But Jay, how do you, especially someone like you, that hard charging type A, how do you manage stress? And what does that even mean, right? Because we all know that we're supposed to do it better. But even I'm like, am I doing it right now? I have no idea. Walk us through that.
Yeah, I mean, I totally get it. It's a great question. It's something that I have to check myself. I'll ask myself the same question, right? But like it's, I think I can go so many different directions with this, but one of them is like simplicity and minimalism. Like I love reading. I'll always reread like Essentialism and the 80-20 principle and The One Thing and books like that, because I can get caught up. I think we all can, especially nowadays. I'm like, oh, I should be doing all this stuff for everything, every aspect of your life. You got to do 500 things, right? So it's like, man, I reread those books all the time, and I reread Stoicism stuff like Seneca and Marcus Aurelius. That helps get me grounded. I'll read a little bit of that each morning, kind of like focus on what's essential. And then, you know, Craig Ballantyne?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Craig's a really good friend of mine for a long time. And going through Craig's Perfect Day workshops and things like this, like really helped me with okay, like scheduling things, systematizing things, and then automate, eliminate, delegate, like stuff that I shouldn't be doing, you know? So that way you don't get as overwhelmed. Then when you kind of put those rules in place for your life, it's like, I could look at you and Sean and be like, well, they're doing a better job with their podcast, but this guy's doing a better job. I got to do every single thing. But it's like, you can't do everything. You know, you got to pick and choose your battles. And I think once you accept that, once you embrace like that minimalism and that 80-20, and you have rules and structure, and then I tend to do best when I go about my day with that really rigid structure. Like if beepers are going off, it's like, all right, I'm done writing. I'm moving on to this thing. And then in terms of stress, like I have to train every single day. It's iron therapy or whatever. You know, I'll lift 4 or 5 days a week. I'll do cardio on the off days. So I'm always doing something. So I want to get to the end of the day like on empty. Like I gave it my all, right? Like I want to be knowing that, okay, I did this. Like for me, for example, I don't schedule stuff. If you said, hey, can we do this at 9:30? Like, absolutely not. From 6 to 10, I focus on my work. I don't do calls. I don't do anything. Even if Michael Jordan was in town and wanted to play one-on-one, I'm like, no, we got to wait till 10:30. You know, like, so I'm really rigid with that. And that helps too. And then again, just training, getting, I spend a lot of time outside. I mean, I live in Florida. So spending time outside, just in nature. I'll walk barefoot on the golf course, getting sun. I'm in the sauna every day. I cold plunge as much as I can. You know, just taking care of yourself like that. And now I sleep better. You know, people always tell you sleep worse as you get older. I prioritized it. So I sleep so much better now than I used to. Like I do all the things. Any new strategy someone's talking about to improve your sleep, I'm trying it immediately. And I really prioritize it. So.
But it probably works especially well because you're getting yourself to that point where your body is exhausted, but not overly exhausted, right? And that helps you sleep better probably.
Exactly. Yep.
And so a lot of people, I've noticed like a lot of times the worst sleep I'll have is on my rest days when I should have probably done something and exhausted myself, but I didn't. But then you get that wired and tired thing later where your body isn't tired, but your brain is totally exhausted. And then you don't get that good sleep.
Yeah. Yep.
And I'm so glad that you said about stress. It's more about like building a system and your schedule than it is about meditating and doing yoga every day and doing Tai Chi, which can be those things can be very helpful, but it's actually a small part because I think a lot of people are just like, oh my God, I'm stressed all the time. And I didn't meditate today for 5 minutes. So that must be the problem. But no, it's a little bit bigger than that. You really have to plan for reducing the amount of stress in your life.
Totally. Yeah, because I've tried like doing all the breath work and the meditating, and I've tried it with type A guys. And yeah, 100%, it's great. It works. But we're all like, yeah, I need something more. That's not enough. That's not doing it. That's not cutting it, you know?
So I've also heard you talk about how those long rest intervals, making sure that you're not over-exercising, especially as we reach our later 30s, our 40s, and the years tick by. How should we change the way that we're training to make sure that we're going after the right sorts of goals and not just burning the candle at both ends?
Mm. So I'm a guy, like I like real-world experience first and foremost, but I do stay up to date on all the latest studies. But I think now we have a whole segment of people on Instagram and everything that don't have real world experience. They only have the latest studies. So they change their opinion every week. So I like to be like, okay, what have I done for 30 years that worked? What has, you know, my 10 friends that have been doing this for 20, 30 years, I talk to them. What do they have seen? What are they doing? What have they seen that works? And then we kind of look at the latest studies and be like, all right, yeah, that kind of makes sense. That validates what we've been doing. Or, you know what, I'm not changing anything based on that study because it doesn't make sense to me. But the latest studies show that taking 3 minutes rest between strength training exercises will, you'll make better gains and you will have less fatigue. So years ago, we all used to think, I said this, everyone said this, that heavy weights, like in a 1 to 3 rep max, would burn out your CNS and cause more fatigue than sets of 20 to 25. Now, science has proven that's the complete opposite. Those hard sets of 20 to 25 will cause more fatigue, you know, systemic, local, whatever, soreness, whatever, the next few days. And you can kind of prove this to yourself. Like if you go to the gym today and you're, let's say, you know, to compare apples to apples, you're training close to failure, 1 to 2 reps shy of failure on each set. If you do, let's say, just 10 work sets and you go 15 to 20 on every set, and then tomorrow you go to the gym and do 6 to 8 on every set, you're going to be way more wiped out from the 15 to 20. So what I'll generally do is, again, taking someone, you know, mid-30s, 40s, 50s, type A, burnt out, I'll be like, all right, what are you doing? Usually they're doing high reps, low rest period. So I'll have them do like 6 to 8, maybe 3 minutes, maybe 2 minutes, depending on the exercise, depending on how strong you are. Like if you're not that strong, 3 minutes is a really long, boring rest interval. So I'll kind of gauge it. And that doesn't make sense to some people, but it's like if you're stronger, like even though I'm nowhere near the size I used to be, I'm still pretty strong. Or sometimes people are training me like, oh, I can't believe you're able to do that much weight. you know, to put it in simple terms, like I could recruit more muscle fibers than maybe a guy who hasn't trained that much. So it just exhausts me. Like maybe out of 100, I'm recruiting 87 and he's only recruiting 55. So it takes me a little longer, you know, to recover between sets. So I might need 3 minutes while this guy might only need two. But again, I'm just going to like, let's do less volume. Let's work on really good form and technique so you don't get injured. I mean, that's the thing. As you get older, you have less leeway. You're in your 20s. You can just hoist weight around and whatever, go up every week. But you get older, you know, all of a sudden you're like, oh, that hurt. My elbow hurts. And you don't want that. Like, knock on wood, right now I feel great. I don't have anything that really hurts. Where all through my 20s and 30s, everything hurt all the time. But because I was training like an idiot, like ego-driven, right? So now I'm not ego-driven. So again, I'll just, you know, reduce the overall number of sets, reduce the number of exercises, lower the reps, increase the rest periods. And then I'll say to someone, all right, just give me like 2-3 weeks. And they're like, I do feel better. I feel way better. I have more energy. My joints don't hurt as much. I'm actually getting stronger. I'm recovering. My testosterone is going up. And I'm like, well, how do you know that? You have it tested? They're like, well, my libido is better. I was like, yeah, okay, good. That's good. You're sleeping more. And then eventually we can, you know, then it becomes individual. What do we want to do with the volume, the rest periods, and all those things? But I think it's in general, it's a good approach to kind of just, you know, get the most with the least you need and then add more later.
And so it's not the cardio bunny approach where you're just burning all of these calories off. It's a little more complicated than that, or at least a little different than that, right?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And so I'll use cardio more for stress reduction, recovery, overall health, you know, cardiovascular health, than fat loss. I the pendulum's always swinging, as you know, right? So like there was a time, late 90s, early 2000s, where cardio was completely useless. Like you don't need to get lean. It doesn't do anything for your health. All you do is lift and run sprints. And I even said that back in those days. But like, I feel like Joel Jameson's done a really good job at spearheading the charge for like, no, cardio has a lot of health benefits. And there's so many studies now, you know, showing the longevity benefits, the cognitive benefits, not just the heart benefits. So I use it, but not specifically for fat loss. I think it's really low in the totem pole for fat loss. It's more just for all the other reasons. And it helps you recover between hard training sessions. And then what I'll do is with HIIT, with high intensity stuff, I don't like to do it the way most people do, which is like 40 seconds on, 60 seconds on, something like that. I've never liked that, even back when I didn't know the things I know today. Like I always prescribe like 10 to 12 seconds, super hard,
more
and then
the
a
burst.
Long rest period. Yeah. Because I would say even back then we didn't have the science. I'll be like, well, look at 100 meter sprinters. They're shredded and they're jacked. And look at distance runners, right? So like, short bursts and long rest periods. That's how I like to do intervals. And really, I'll only have people do intervals once a week. The other stuff's going to be low intensity, maybe medium intensity. Again, depending on the individual, what they can recover from.
And if you overdo the cardio, especially if it's highly glycolytic, then it's a huge driver of hunger too. And then that gets away from people, right?
Yeah. A shout out to Pavel Tatsalin, who's, you know, been, I think, more so Joel, but Pavel's definitely talked about like anti-glycolytic, you know, high intensity stuff, the benefits of that versus just burning your system out.
Yeah. And it's important to recognize that if you are after body composition, then just putting in more miles can be more of a liability at times than especially hitting more strength-based workouts. So especially as you were leaning down, like you said, from basically getting visible abs as you entered your 40s, which is an unusual thing to do for most people. That's when they disappear for most people for the rest of their lives. And they never see them again. How did you balance training with hunger and making sure you're not under eating or overeating? Cause that's a hard balance to get.
Yeah. Well, I am a fat Italian by nature. Like I love to eat, my mom's side of the family is Scottish, so we love to drink. Like I have it from all sides. So it's a challenge. So I get it. Like when people are like struggling with that, I get it. Like every day I just want to eat everything in sight. But I've experimented with everything. You know, I've done keto. I did, I think from 96 to 98, I was on a cyclic ketogenic diet for like 2 years straight. And I did pretty well with that. I mean, I've done, you name it. I've done a carb cycling, fasting, whatever. Whereas now I tend to, with most people, and the approach that works best for me is a little bit more, like just to throw some basic numbers out there, I'll go like a gram of protein per pound of body weight, around a gram of carbs. I know, like, I don't really love low carb, especially for my type of guys who are like, those type A hard charging people, that's just another stress, right? Like if you're like, hey, I'm eating 30 grams of carbs a day, I'm like, yeah, you're gonna feel terrible. Let's get rid of that immediately. And then I'll keep the fat lower. So I may go 0.3 to 0.4. And eventually, because there is a difference between physique and optimal health, and you got to find the balance in what you're okay with. So many times, first, people just want the physique. So, okay, so to get there, that's what I did too. Like, I had to consciously lower my fat intake like a bodybuilder would do, which I'd never done my whole life. So I brought it down really low where I'm only, for me, I was eating like 55, 60 grams of fat a day. But now I eat more, I just feel a lot better, right? But I'm not as ripped. So you got to decide what's the balance. But I feel better, I sleep better, I recover better. So, but if you were like, hey, you got to be ready for a cover of a magazine, I'd be like, all right, I go back to that because that worked better for me. So that's what I tend to do, is a little bit more carb, a little bit lower fat, and then slowly over time raise the fat up. And it tends to be kind of like paleo-ish for the most part. That's what I do for the first 30 days. Everyone's basically paleo. And then if you can tolerate white rice, I'll add some of that in. Tolerate like sourdough bread, I'll add some of that. And I'm definitely not one of those people who's scared of fruit. So I personally eat a ton of fruit, and I have most of my guys eat a ton of fruit, and they get lean. They have no issues with that.
Cool.
So, yeah. And then in terms of like, you know, balancing hunger, I feel like if I just eat the right things in the right ratios, I'm not that hungry. I like three or four meals spread out. When I was doing intermittent fasting, I would just lose my mind. I was so hungry all the time. So that's what I tend to do. And I find that, again, for that type A kind of guy, intermittent fasting just becomes another stressor, right? Like those guys will come to me, they're training like animals, and they're fasting, and they're drinking coffee all day, and they're low carbs. It's like, yeah, bro, we got to change everything. So I'll have them eat immediately when they first get out of bed. Like, let's eat. Also, they're chugging a gallon of water when they get out of bed in the morning. I'm like, yeah, that's even more stressful. And they're like, wait, what? But everyone in the fitness industry says I got to wake up and chug a gallon of water. I was like, well, just trust me on that. Don't do that. Get up and eat and just drink a normal amount of water. And a week later, like, oh, I have less anxiety. I'm like, yeah, just like, you don't have to do all these crazy things all the time.
Yeah. Let's talk about that a little bit more, because that is one thing that people have just been saying for a long time, that the more water you drink, the better. And I used to run longer distances, like marathons and stuff like that. So I knew that it's more about balancing your electrolytes and making sure you don't have to pee all the time. Like, that's not a good thing. But still, it kind of persists that people are walking around with these big jugs of water and just slugging them down all day. Why is that not such a good idea?
Yeah, so I feel like, who was the first person that kind of got my mind shit? It was like someone in the, like the Ray Pete circle, right?
Okay.
And so for those who don't know, Ray Pete focuses on like raising your metabolism, certain foods you shouldn't eat, certain foods you should eat. And he thinks that a lot of the traditional mainstream fitness stuff is totally incorrect. And so I think one of those was like just chugging water all day. Like if your dog pees clear for a few days, like, oh, I got to take him to the vet. But we wear that as a badge of honor. Like, oh, I'm so fit and healthy. I'm hydrated. Like, there's this cult of hydration, you know, where it's like, I'm so hydrated, I'm peeing clear all day. It's like, yeah, but that doesn't mean you're healthy. That just means you're stressed out. If you're peeing clear, you're stressed out. Like, you have catecholamines, like stress hormones, adrenaline, cortisol are just through the roof. Like, you shouldn't be doing that. You should have like pale yellow urine. If it looks like a Red Bull when you pee, like, yeah, then drink some water.
Right.
Like, that's not good. But like you don't want to just be chugging water all day. And every single time I have someone do that where they stop doing that and they go from the clear urine to like pale yellow, like, I can't believe this. I actually feel less anxiety. Like one of my best friends, he's an actor, director, producer. He's like super high strung. And I was like, bro, why are you chugging a gallon of water every day? He's like, I don't know. I'm supposed to be fit and healthy. I was like, just stop doing that. And he's like, I cannot believe this. I have so much less stress and anxiety. So just drink like when you're thirsty. Like nobody, it's funny because that's one of the rules too, is wake up and you got to chug 64 ounces or 32 ounces of water. But I'm like, why? And they're like, oh, because you dehydrate overnight. I'm like, yeah, but I didn't play one-on-one with Michael Jordan in my sleep or something. Like I didn't sleepwalk 10 miles in Miami Heat or something. Like, yeah, I breathed and maybe I sweat a little bit, but I don't wake up like I just got out of the desert and there's just sweat pouring. Like, yeah, I'll have a glass of water. Okay, I'm good. I don't need to chug this huge thing, you know?
Yeah. What about pre-feeding workouts or just eating in the morning? Are you going after protein first? What does that look like?
I like to have like a balanced meal first thing. So I'll generally just get up. I'll have eggs, I'll have like a cup of fruit and like maybe a half a sweet potato. Like depending on if I'm going to be training that day, I'll probably have a half a sweet potato. Like I have some starch in before I train. So that's basically what I eat. And I generally try to, I'd say eight times out of 10, I'll have food before I have coffee. So I wake up, have water with electrolytes. So I never drink water without electrolytes. So I always have like a pack of Element or something in there. So drink some water, some electrolytes, some supplements, and then I'll eat. Generally, like I said, it'll be like four or five eggs and a mix of egg whites, and then some sweet potatoes, some fruit. I feel great doing that. And then I'll have coffee. Ideally, I will always be awake for an hour, preferably two. And I'll get outside and walk the dogs, get, you know, sunlight on me for 15, 20 minutes, then have coffee. If it's just one of those days where like you got to get, you know, a ton of stuff done, and like then I will have coffee sometimes first. But I pay for it because then I'll crash. Like I'll feel it. I actually feel like I'll start getting a little sweaty. My hands and feet will actually get a little sweaty and cold at the same time. And that's just, I know, okay, stress hormones are skyrocketing. I'll start peeing clear. Like I knew better. I shouldn't have done that. I'm really sensitive to that type of thing. So I always eat first, and then I'll feel better. And also sleep better when I do that too, which is crazy.
Yeah, well, it definitely makes sense. So is that to make sure that you don't have caffeine as a crutch, and then the fasting kind of gets away from you because you're already stimulated before you can eat breakfast? Or what's the thinking
there? Yeah, like again, being, you know, the way I am personality-wise, like my cortisol is already cranking. So now I'm just skyrocketing with the caffeine. And then again, I'll crash. Whereas if I have my food in my stomach and I wait, the caffeine's kind of like a nice, easy, kind of slow burn. And I don't need as much. But if I wake up, I chug coffee, then I need like six cups. Like I just gotta keep chugging because I'm going up and down,
riding
up
the train.
And down. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Interesting. You know, I never really thought about it quite like that, but very similar to sugar or even alcohol, if you think about it that way. It's like you have a drink at noon or something, as soon as you stop drinking, you're going to fall asleep. And probably very similar with sugar and caffeine. If you're hitting the caffeine as soon as you wake up, I think your point is very well taken. Get outside, try to walk a little bit. It doesn't have to be a big exercise or anything like that, but just like getting yourself moving, maybe a light sweat with some sun on your face, hitting your eyes, hitting your skin. So important, a lot more important than exogenous substances that'll get you cranked. When does that crash happen for you? If you hit the caffeine in the morning?
I'd say probably around, like I'll start feeling weirdness around my eyes. I'm like, oh, here we go. It's not pain, but it's like, I'm starting to, it's probably like within 2 hours. And again, like eight, nine times out of 10, I'll eat. But if it's one of those days that I haven't eaten, I'm just chugging coffee because I'm like, I got so much to do. And I'm like, I'll just feel it. And then I can't get ahead of it the rest of the day. Like then I'm kind of just all day, my body temperature's down. I'm kind of cold. My hands and feet are a little cold. But I'm a little sweaty and kind of like just off the whole day.
What about portions, especially if you're spreading the meals out across the day? How do you make sure that those meals aren't kicking off your hunger, or you're eating a little bit too much too early in the day? Or how do you manage that and balance it out?
I like to have, from a social perspective, and I guess from an energy perspective too, I like to have my biggest meal at night. One of the things I do that helps me sleep better, well, I just mentioned one, which is get that natural sunlight first thing in the morning. The other thing is now I stop eating. Like I used to eat and go to bed like 30 to 60 minutes later. Now it's 3 hours. It's a minimum of two. Like on a bad day, it's two, but it's ideally three. So I eat dinner way earlier, and then I have that time. I go for a long walk. Generally after every meal, I will go for a 10-minute walk, which just helps my digestion, helps with bloating, helps with gas. I feel so much better. But I like to have that. So I'll have my first meal like around 6:37. Then I'll do like, you know, 11:30, 12-ish. And then I generally train after that at like 1:30. And then I'll have a meal right after that at 2:33, whatever. And then I'll eat dinner like 6:30. And with those three kind of moderate size meals and then one bigger meal at night, I feel great. Like I'm never really that hungry. I feel fantastic doing that. Like I said, I've tried everything. That seems to work really well for me now.
Yeah. And it's so important to know what does work best. And sometimes that moves around a little bit, depending on what you're your goals are, what you're training for. Are you, I'm curious about like what exactly you're training for as a goal. Is it to maximize certain lifts, to reduce the amount of times, to make yourself faster? Or like what exactly are you targeting and how does that change over time?
I would yell at a client if they said this because it's kind of vague. But like I've been doing it professionally, you know, for like 27 years now. So I kind of know like I'm just fighting Father Time. Like I want to be jacked. I want to be lean. I want to be strong. I want to be able to perform. Like there's certain things strength wise that I can do at 48 and weighing 40 pounds less than I did at 28. You know, I'm stronger.
That's rad.
You know, my jump, my vertical jump is still pretty good. You know, I would guess that my sprint speed is probably slower. But I like to be able to move well. I like to not be in pain, which again, knock on wood, like that's a huge badge of honor. Because I know when you're younger and you're a meathead, something's always bothering you. And you know, guys my age, something's always bothering them. Where I'm like, no, man, I feel pretty good. You know, there's going to be something. Like if you've been an athlete or done anything your whole life, you get to nearly 50. Like of course you're going to have some wear and tear and some mileage. Otherwise, you know, you probably haven't done anything. But for the most part, you know, that considered, I feel pretty good. So I like being pain free. I like being strong. I like to move well, and to still be athletic and be able to do stuff. Like if you know if someone's in town, they're like, "Hey, you want to go train? Yeah, I can do anything you want. Let's go. You want to go paddleboarding? Sure. You want to go surfing? Sure. You want to go hiking? Sure. Like I like to you know be able to do all those things. So I don't have like a visual. I mean, of course, like everybody, or at least you know as a meathead, there, I'd like to look like The Rock, but like I don't have the genetics for that. You know what I mean?
But it's important to train up. To be able to do the types of things that you want to do. And I've heard you speak about this before where instead of just showing up to the gym and wanting to be strong or just showing up and doing the same thing every time, it's really important, especially to keep yourself interested, to build skills and to develop those skills and get better and better as you spend your time in there. So maybe you can just riff on that a bit.
Well, that's what's fun for me is, and people that I work with, especially people that come, we have a live event or anyone, you know, that I work with in person is, I think every exercise is a skill where, you know, you could say, okay, well, a snatch is a skill and a deadlift is a skill. Sure. But the way I coach and again, for me and people I work with, that becomes somewhere I'm like, yeah, but a lateral raise is a skill and a one-arm pushdown is a skill too. Like if you really do it the way I want you to do it and execute right, and you're not just using momentum and every other muscle group, you know, when I was younger and I squatted, it was like, whatever muscles get this up, get it up. Like just put 315 up, put 405 on. It doesn't matter if it's my hips, my back, if I can't get out of bed tomorrow. Or now I'm like, well, what are we trying to train there? You're like quads. Okay. Well, now we have an idea of what the lift should look like. So I you know, and again, for older guys, I like to target muscles more than like, let's just hoist massive amounts of weight no matter what. Because as you get older, you know, my friend, Dr. Gabrielle Lyon always talks about how muscle is like the ultimate anti-aging organ, right? So like you want to have as much muscle as you can as you age. So let's train in a way that's smart, that doesn't beat up your joints, it doesn't break your back, it doesn't, you know, wreck your hips. And then I'll take someone, like anytime I'm training with someone, I'm coaching the whole time. I have fun. Like even if it's just a friend of mine, someone's in town. Like, all right, let's go. And I will be coaching every millimeter of every rep. Like, try this a little. See how your elbow's there? Just move it here. Like, dude, it's the first time I've done that in 20 years with no pain. So, and that's what I do. When I'm training myself, that's what still makes it fun. Because instead of like mindlessly pumping away and checking my phone, like what I got to do later, I'm like, all right, how can I make this dumbbell press? How can I feel my chest even more and zero stress in my shoulders, zero stress in my elbows or wrists? What if I just bent my wrist like this a little bit? And I'm like, oh, it's a light bulb moment. I'll write that down. I'm like, let me try that with some of the guys and see if they feel the same way. So I'm always trying to do that. I'm always trying to develop those skills. And obviously, the more complex the exercise, the more you want to work on it like that. And because I'm so old school, like I love, you know, Arthur Saxon and George Hackenschmidt and, you know, things from like 1906. Like they used to say training should be, they don't call it a workout. They call it practice. So you go in, you're practicing to get better, which is, I mean, I like to train hard, but there's still that element of practice. Like, how do we get better each day? And also that goes back to what we've been talking about the whole time. You don't burn yourself out as much, right? Whereas if you're going in, you're like, let me do this with perfect form. I'm practicing. So I don't have to take every set to death failure where my eyeballs are popping out and everything. It's like, no, I'll leave a little so I could come back tomorrow. I feel good. And again, if you want to be active and ready, to do things. If you train to failure and just destroy yourself on every set of every exercise, you'd be wiped out the next day. And like, that's not fun. That's how I spent, you know, so many years. So I think if you embrace that mindset, you just enjoy training more. And then also, like, you want to set PRs, you want to be able to get better at things, but it's not the way that I used to do it. And I would have told you, where you're like, all right, just beat the logbook no matter what happens. All right, you did 315 for 10 last week. I don't care what happens. You have to get it for 11 or your whole life's a failure. You know what I mean? And then you do that for enough time and years and you're like, bro, my whole body feels terrible. So now I tell my guys, yeah, like, of course we want to get stronger. If you can only press 35-pound dumbbells today and you're doing that for 10 in a year, you've probably gotten nowhere. But slowly over time, next week, maybe you get them for the same amount of reps. Next week, maybe you get one more rep. The following week, maybe you slept horribly and your nutrition was off and you get them for less reps. That doesn't mean that you didn't progress. Like, progression can never just be linear like this. Like, it's more like if you invested in a stock, right? Like, it goes up, then it plateaus, then it goes down. You don't freak out when it goes down. Then it goes here, and then it goes up, and then it goes back down. Like, it's just like, strength training is the only physical endeavor where people think, a certain subset of the population thinks, that you can linearly get better 52 weeks in a row. Whereas if I went out and played golf today and I shot a 120, I wouldn't think that next week I'm shooting a 110, the next week I'm shooting a 100, the next week I'm shooting 190. Like, it's just over time. So if you're realistic with your body and the rate at which connective tissue adapts, you can avoid getting injured. Training is more fun, because training is not fun when you're always injured. And generally, like, your muscles can adapt pretty quick, but your connective tissue doesn't. So you got to take the progression a little slower than you'd want to. Like, it's fun to say, yeah, I put 30 pounds on my squat in a month. Cool. But I guarantee your knees and hips and back are going to hurt in the next 2, 3, 4 weeks, you know? Like, so take it a little bit slower. Think about long term. Like, think 12 months as opposed to, like, 12 weeks even.
Yeah. And how have you seen people get injured? What I really want to ask is, how do we not get injured? But I'm curious, like, some of the mistakes that you've seen, because I'm sure there are a lot of different ones, as well as some common themes there.
Yes. So the first thing is, like, what are the two most common injuries in the world? Golfer's elbow and tennis elbow. And that's from repeatedly doing the same thing with an implement that weighs, like, you know, a pound or less. So doing the same things just with high volume over and over, especially if your form isn't good. So most injuries are overuse injuries. They're not catastrophic injuries. Catastrophic injuries, like you'd see on Gym Fail or something, where someone squats down and, like, breaks their back. Like, that's so not bad. Good. But that doesn't happen that much. It's more just like, oh man, now I have tendonitis in my elbow. Or I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden my shoulder kills, and then your shoulder kills for the next 8 weeks. You don't know what exactly did it. That's more just from an accumulation of volume over time, right? So it's a volume, and it's volume with poor form. So that's why I always say to everyone, let's do less volume at the beginning and let's dial in your technique. Okay, now if you're doing less volume and great technique, now we can layer more volume on top of it. How much do you need? I don't know. That's individual. Probably less than most people think. But again, it's just overall, at the end of the day, it's volume, volume, volume. Most you look at professional sports. Football, of course, there's catastrophic injuries. There's catastrophic injuries if you land wrong in basketball. But most things are the accumulation of volume and fatigue, too. Like, even certain catastrophic injuries, like if a guy cuts one way and his knee goes the other, it's not necessarily that his hamstrings or his quads or his glutes or whatever weren't strong enough to handle that force he was able to produce. It's just he's so fatigued from so much volume, so many games, so much training. Not enough sleep, too many flights, poor nutrition, poor hydration, right? So it's like all those things add up to injuries. If you just put a ton of weight on the bar and squat down 2 inches and flip over like on Gym Fail, well, that's idiotic. That's stupid. Yeah. I've injured myself doing that plenty of times. You know, those injuries aren't really like, whoa, what a mystery. How did that happen?
Yeah.
You know, like, that's pretty obvious. You were just ego lifting. So I don't ego lift anymore. And I try to make sure that most people that I work with don't ego lift. And then, and then you shouldn't get injured as much.
How do you know if you're ego lifting or not? Do you need someone else to call BS on you, or like?
You probably do at first. Yeah, you probably need to train with someone or have, you know, a coach overseeing yourself and being like, dude, that's way too heavy. Like, I'll do that to some of my best friends who are really well known colleagues. I won't name anybody, but we're training. Like, I'm just a Jersey guy, you know. Like, we'll be training together. I'm like, bro, you like. I go, how many did you get? Because I'm competitive, so I want to try to get what they got or beat them. And they'll go eight. And I go, bro, I'm counting four on that. Those last four were horrible. I was too heavy. Now I'm going to do eight, you know? But like, yeah. So I think you need someone who's going to be brutally honest and check yourself. And then you can simply just like, everyone's got a camera now, film yourself. Be like, does that look good? Does that look like I tell, like, again, because I'm really into technique and not getting injured. So I'll tell people, hey, man, like I'd say to you, like if you're going to the gym today and you're going to train upper body, I'd be like, all right, Abel, when you do your dumbbell presses, I want you to consider this is the one set of dumbbell presses that will be filmed forever. And that's what everyone's going to learn forever. Your set of dumbbell presses. So make it that good, you know, and that's what I try to do when I'm training. So I think those things help, and you know, just being realistic with yourself, and then watching the video back. Like I'll video myself as often as I can, or if someone's with me, I'll watch it. I'll be like, in my head, I was like, that was a perfect set, and then I'll watch it like, oh man, my elbows were a little too flared there. So you're always getting better, you know. Like, you know, I mean, Kobe Bryant to his dying day, like he was always trying to get better. Like everyone, you know, that practices mastery is going to get further and get better results if you're always. And like you said before, it's just going to be more fun, I think.
And one thing that you've said before is, what will this workout do to me tomorrow? It's a really important question to ask that a lot of people don't, because it's all about the performance in the gym or on the field that day. When if you're looking at long-term training and if you actually want to get better, you really have to ask that question. It's not about hitting that PR as much as like, how does your recovery look so that you could hit the PR after that, or at least hit the next goal after that, right? So it's more about longer-term thinking about programming and training.
100%, dude. Yeah. So like what I'll do is if I'm going to try something new, because I'm like, oh, maybe I'll play with this and see, you know, then I'll give it to some of my guys. I will look at my Aura Ring score the next day based on that. And then just how do I feel? Am I sore? Am I stiff? Am I fatigued? Do I need more caffeine today? Is my score 70 on my Aura Ring, or is it 90? And then that's a way that I'll kind of gauge stuff too. So yeah, that's huge. How you feel? Because you're always going to feel great at the end of the workout. You know, you're always on that high. You have endorphins. You're like, oh, that was amazing. And the next day, if you can't get out of bed, you're like, man, not so amazing.
How sore should you feel the next day though, or a few days after? What does that look like?
I think minimal. I think minimally sore. I think soreness is a bad gauge of a workout. Like, I actually will be in a bad mood. I don't like getting sore.
Yeah.
I just think it's unnecessary inflammation, so it's more stress. You know, I don't like it. Like I have a tiny bit of soreness. I'm like, all right, that's perfect. I don't need any more than that, you know? And then if you are sore, what a lot of people will do is they'll be like, oh, I'm just taking off today. That's the worst thing you can do. That's the worst thing you do if you're sore or if you're injured. Like, always keep moving. Like, if you're like, oh, I did way too many sets of chest today, yesterday, I'm sore. Okay, cool. Go in, train another muscle group, or do cardio that involves, like, you know, do the assault bike and the skier. Like, just get blood pumping everywhere, and that soreness will alleviate itself, and you'll feel much better tomorrow versus just sitting there. And I found that as I've gotten older too, I don't know if you'd agree, but like I used to be able to train 3-4 days a week and just sit on the couch 3-4 days. Now at 48, I feel horrible. I have to move every single day or I feel terrible.
Yeah, I have noticed that rest days have started to feel worse. It's not that thing where you can just wreck yourself and then it's hard to go up the stairs because you're so sore or whatever. And then you just kind of hang out for a day and you're good the next day. It's like, no. If you don't do that active recovery, then you're going to be sore for a few days and it's not going to be pretty at all. But one thing as well I'd love to talk to you about is, it seems to me anyway that music is a big part of training and physical enjoyment and just kind of using your body at the same time that you're using your mind and listening to fun beats or fun tunes that you enjoy. Talk about that a little bit, because that's been huge for me over the course of everything I've done in athletics. A lot of that has been driven by music, my love for that. But talk about that from your perspective.
Yeah, I mean, music, I could talk about music more than training, quite frankly. Like, I love it. I am obsessed. Like, I just grew up on old school hip hop, you know, in Jersey and New York. For, you know, being from Jersey, of course, I grew up listening to Bruce. You know, my parents were listening to Bruce and Tom Petty and The Who and all that. So I love classic rock. But like, hip hop is my heart and soul. Every day since 1984, 84, 85, I listen to hip hop like all day. Like, I have a thing. You can never, if someone turns off the music in my car, I'll lose my mind. Like, music always has to be on. You can't, if you want to talk, like, it's super serious, we got to just turn it down. We can't turn it off. All day in my house, there's music playing. But certainly, it's the fuel for workouts. I mean, I spend an inordinate amount of time where, like, business advisor or something, like, bro, you're putting so much time into those playlists. I'm like, I know, but I love it. Like, I just love the amount of playlists I have, like training playlists I have on my phone. And then I'm always sharing. Like, I will literally spend 15 to 30 minutes a day just sending people, like, bro, you got to put this onto your workout today. Like, crazy, you know, like friends we mentioned, like Bedros, Sean, whatever, Luca. I'll be texting them all day, songs. Like, I just, you know, just recently, Dave from De La Soul died, and De La Soul is one of my favorite groups ever. Their music just finally got released on streaming. And like, I'm getting goosebumps now because music for me, any point in my life, like I could tell you the song, or if you play the song, like I could tell you where I was, what I was thinking, how I was acting, what relationship I was in. Like, it's like I have goosebumps head to toe. Like, music just is like, if we're out somewhere and someone goes, oh, who are your top five lyricists? I go, all right, we're gonna be here for 3 hours. You ready to start? You know, like, I just love talking music. I've seen more concerts than anyone I know. So yeah, I can't imagine. Like, sometimes I go into people's gym who own a gym, like a small private training facility, and they just have the radio on. I'm like, bro, how do you not spend like 12 hours a week curating playlists and stuff like that? Like, I love doing that. The music's the foundation for everything.
And it can be such a powerful motivator, as long as it's a good match for you and you like what you're listening to. But one thing that drives me nuts too is sometimes you go into that gym or that place and they just have the radio playing and you're listening to commercials for like half the time you're in there working out. I'm like, what is going on here? Like, why are you not paying $3.99 a month to just make sure this doesn't happen in your gym?
Yeah, it's crazy. I know. And so I have a morning playlist that I listen to, again, because I was so shy and quiet and insecure and socially awkward over. So I play this morning playlist every morning to kind of get my mindset to reprogram myself. Even though I'm so far removed from that, I still just want to set the tone for the day. So when I get up and I'm, you know, doing my morning routine and brushing my teeth and making coffee and making food, like, I have this whole curated playlist of just programming myself to be like, you know, I'm the greatest. I'm focused. I'm dominant. I'm unstoppable. And, you know, a lot of hip hop on there. There's even like the Rocky, the Eye of the Tiger and the Superman theme song on there and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah. Never fails. So it's music with lyrics mostly.
Yeah. Yep.
But the lyrics are important because they're programming your subconscious.
Yeah.
Right?
Super important. Yeah.
That's something that I feel like, you know, our generation or people who are a little bit older seem to get that and jive with that. I've had a lot of people who say, you know, I never listen to the lyrics or whatever. You may not think you're listening to the lyrics, but your subconscious is, and it's programming you. So I love the kind of,
well,
link
that's one
between
of the things
that.
I love about hip hop when I was a kid was, here's this really shy, insecure kid, but every day in my ear, I hear LL saying, I'm bad, and DMC saying, I'm the king of rock, you know, Sucker MC should call me sire, and Special Ed saying, I'm the magnificent. So I was like, that helped me for so many years. That helped me be like, all right, I got to think bigger. I got to be more confident. I got to be more braggadocious. I got to, like, you know, like, and even though it was a struggle, it was a challenge, but just playing those words in my, you know, cassette player, my Walkman every day, it did help me. And to this day, it still helps me.
How cool is that? Well, I have so many more things that we could talk through today, but we're just about out of time. Jay, did we miss anything? And what's the best place to find you and all of your work?
I don't know, dude, like, so you're so good at this. I feel like I tell you this every time, but this is always my most fun podcast. Like, I could talk for 3-4 hours. So thank you so much.
Right on.
It's always so enjoyable. Yeah, I feel like, dude, whatever you want to talk about, let's go. But j.fit, that'll take you to my website, just because my name is, my last name's long and hard to spell and hard to remember. I'm at Jay Ferruggia on Instagram and Renegade Strength Show on Spotify, Apple, all the places.
Awesome. Jay, you are the best. Anyone who is not familiar with Jay's work, please go check out. His writing is awesome. His motivation, his podcast, even all of your guest interviews. I saw you with John Berardi on kind of like a guest interview. You hang out with so many other of the top minds in health, fitness, strength, and conditioning. And so anyone out there, please check out Jay's work. It rocks. You rock, Jay. Thanks so much for coming on.
Thank you.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about,
friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate nut cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.